introduction. It's indeed a great pleasure for me to be back here in Dehradun. I was here 7 years ago and had a great experience, and thank you to you and Dr. Garg for inviting me back here. I think that I also appreciate very much that the organizers of this conference have been so kind to use some of our quite recent STM work, which was acquired since I last was here in Dehradun, and use that as a logo for this conference. So what I'd like to do is just start briefly discussing the demand for clean fuels. We heard an excellent overview in the introduction by Lal yesterday and by Dr. Garg. But I would like to stress that once you go to the new clean fuels regulations, there are some new reaction issues that you have to take into account. It's not just an issue of getting a little bit more activity and 30% more catalyst in your reactors and so on. There are some new issues. The main part of my talk, I'll discuss the fundamental studies, and especially all the new insight we have gained since I was here in 1999 last time. And we have really been able to make quite a bit of progress. And now you actually have quite detailed atomic and molecular information about the catalyst and the surface type of reactions that you have to deal with. So this is really the first time we have moved to the state where we have detailed atomic and molecular insight. And once you have that, you are of course in a completely new and more favorable situation, and you can in fact use that to design more active and more selective catalysts to meet the different needs that the refiners have. Well, we have heard a lot about the role of hydrotreating. I think Mr. Lal said yesterday that that's probably the most important singular reaction in the refiner today. And of course, we have to hydrotreat more and more products. We have a huge increase in the demand for fuels in India and in China especially. And then on top of that, we have a demand for making cleaner and cleaner transportation fuels. And if you just talk about diesel, everywhere in the world, we are moving towards 50 ppm or lower. And in India today, actually several places, you are producing such low fuels. And again, I would like to just stress that there are some fundamentally new issues that you have to take into account when you go to these very low sulfur levels. So, what you have to do in order to solve the need of the refiner is actually to take an integrated approach, take into many different accounts both engineering aspects and catalyst aspects. Of course, you have to understand the kinetics, and there will be more talks about that at this meeting from Borge. But it's not only important to understand the kinetics, you have to understand also how the different nanostructures in the catalyst are responsible for different functionalities and different type of reactions in the catalyst. Because if you don't understand how the different nanostructures dictate the kinetics, then you're not really in the position to design and produce more active and selective catalysts. So you have to have that link. But that's not enough. Today it is extremely important to look at the reactors. You cannot have bypasses. That will, of course, not allow you to achieve ultra low sulfur diesel. So actually, the internals, it's very important that you also introduce state-of-the-art internals and that you look at the whole reactor layout and how it is interacting with the surrounding units for H2S removal and so on. So you have to take an integrated approach. Well, if you go back to 1980, at that time there have been many thousands of studies in hydrotreating. And a lot of good ideas were out there, but it turned out that there was very little specific structural information known about the hydrotreating catalyst. I think at that time there was maybe 10 different schools believing either they were monolayers or believing there were intercalations and so on. And it turned out in retrospect that probably the best idea proposed at that time was actually by Paul Ratnasamy and Sivasanga in an excellent review they published at that time. But anyway, there was no really firm evidence. You did not really have the techniques. So for us, this was not really a very desirable situation. So we thought that the first thing we had to do to get rid of this kind of trial and error development, which is of course very lengthy and very costly, was to try to develop some methods where you could look into the reactors and try to find out what structures you have. So we spent quite a few years trying to see if we could develop some new techniques or modify existing techniques such that you could look at the structures, the hydrotreating structures. And one of the key things that we emphasized, and I know that Iwasawa will also talk about this later on, that was the necessity to do the characterization in situ. And the reason we emphasized that a lot was that we had studied many catalysts when we saw that they restructured. For example, ammonia synthesis catalysts and others. So you need to study them in the right environment. If you just remove a catalyst from the reactor, you may get confused by the information you obtain. Another reason that we emphasized the in situ tools was quite obvious, because if you characterize the catalyst while it's working, it is of course very easy to establish direct relationships between the information you obtain and the activity of the catalyst. So you can get these very useful structure activity relationships. Then of course we had the extra requirement that these techniques should be able to characterize X-ray amorphous structures. So we developed and modified techniques like MusBauer. We transformed it into MusBauer emission spectroscopy so you could study these catalysts. We introduced X-rays to the study of these catalysts. Different ways of using infrared spectroscopy, also using probe molecules. And all of this was turned out to be quite useful. I could say that we keep on emphasizing the development of in situ tools. And I should mention here, I'm not going to discuss it in this talk, but just a few years ago, we were able to modify electron microscopy and high-resolution electron microscopy in a way that you can get atomically resolved electron microscopy images while the catalyst is in an environment. We have been able to study, for example, whisker formation, carbon nanotube formation at 700 degrees centigrade in situ. And that has been extremely useful, and this has also really given us a lot of insight into how dynamic a catalyst is. Small changes in reaction environment, the whole structure may change. So what have we learned about the hydrotreating catalyst? Well, all of these techniques, when you combine them, they told us quite a few things about the type of structures you have. Molybdenum is basically present as quite often even as single layers, molybdenum disulfide type structures. And then the promoter atoms, the cobalt atoms, they turn out to be present in many different forms. And one of the most interesting forms, as you know, is the so-called COMOS phases. That is structures, MOS2 type structures, where you have the promoter atoms located somewhere along the edges. So these in situ techniques gave quite a bit of new insight. And you could also get information into the other type of structures that you may have in this catalyst. And it turns out that not all of these structures are desirable. They do not give the refiner any benefit to have the cobalt present as some of these separate sulfides or to have cobalt wasted inside the alumina support. The big advantage of the in situ characterization is that you can link the structural information, the quantitative structural information with activity. And I just show one example here where you can see that the HGS, the hydrogen activity, is directly correlated to the number of cobalt atoms you have at the edges of these molybdenum disulfide type structures in these so-called COMOS structures. And it's only when you hardly have any cobalt atoms at the edges, then the activity is dictated by the unpromoted molybdenum disulfide, and also here it is the edge atoms which are really responsible for the activity. And we will return to the holy grail, what is really the nature of the sites, and this is something that also Bert Davis and others have discussed yesterday. Of course, we would like to get insight into what is the nature of the sites. So now we know what we need to do. If we need to make a better catalyst, let's try to optimize the concentration of cobalt which ends up in these active phases, and let's avoid all the other phases. So this is at least one of the design criteria. So how do you do that? Well, you simply just use all the different methods, try to characterize all the different preparations that you can think about, and how you calcine, how you sulfide, how you use different supports, how you impregnate, and so on. And of course, as I think everyone in this audience would expect, all the catalyst preparation parameters are extremely crucial. If you change just one parameter, you can change the whole structure and the phase and the activity of the final catalyst. But the nice thing is that by having all these new techniques, you can characterize the different preparation procedures, and you can start to understand how different variations in preparations affect the formation of the active phases. And in some cases, you may be lucky that you have very specific precursor structures with sulfides. So many researchers have been looking into this, and of course, preparation parameters is an absolutely essential thing you have to study. So now, you could say that based on this information, we know what to form, we know how to form it. So, what you saw from the 80s up to 2000 and early 2000s, that a lot of new catalysts were produced, giving the refiners a huge benefit from having much more active catalysts to their disposal. Well, one of the things we observed, coming back to the issue of support interactions, which has also been studied here at IIP a lot, and is still being studied, and there are still many intriguing things about support interactions in these systems. And Murada told me that they have some very interesting new results. But what we found some years ago was that you can actually transform some of these coma structures from a low activity to a high activity form, which was termed type 2 comas. So in these structures, each cobalt edge atom has a higher intrinsic activity. So the turnover frequency of the cobalt atoms are much higher for the type 2 structures, and there's also other ways that you can modify. And this has given opportunities to improve the activity of the industrial catalyst further. And actually, if you look at the catalyst coming out from our company and also from our competitors, you can see that all of these catalysts, more recent catalysts, contain type 2 coma structures. So this has indeed been a very important development for the industry, and have made a lot of good catalysts available for them for meeting their needs. So let's now return to the issue of the fundamental understanding. Just by having structure-activity relationships doesn't necessarily give you a detailed understanding of the mechanism and the nature of the sites. Well, one thing we thought that could be the active sites in these catalysts, and many people have been speculating about this, and that is that you have somehow sulfur vacancies at the surface of the sulfides. And this goes back to the early proposals of Skoig and others. So we were lucky that we worked together with Jens Nørskov, who was in my group for many years, but later on established a big group, and is one of the fathers of density functional theory. has developed himself and many of the codes that is used around the world, that around 1999, we felt that the density function theory had developed to a stage where you can now start to use it also for highly treating cattle. So we used the density function theory, and we tried to see, is there indeed a correlation between the activity and the sulfur, the metal sulfur bond energy? So, in other words, is there a correlation between the tendency to create vacancies and the activity? Well, this is the vacancy creation energy for pure molybdenum sulfide. If you add iron, it doesn't really make it easier to create vacancies. But that fits nicely because iron is not a good promoter for highly treating catalysts. If you, on the other hand, add cobalt or nickel to the structures, then it becomes much easier to create vacancies. So, let's say at the first time around, you could say that this fits pretty good with that vacancies do play a role in these sulfides. And if you look at some of the, well, here's the activity levels, you can see there's a pretty good correspondence. But if you look at all the transition metal sulfides, which has been measured by Chianelli or by Prince and others, we found out that there is also a reasonable correlation between the activity, the hydrotreating activity, and then the metal sulfur bond energy. And the most active metals or metal sulfides are the ones where it's most easy to create vacancies. So this gives us some idea about the nature of the active sites. I will tell you that it is quite a bit more complicated, and it doesn't tell you all the things that you need if you have to make ultra-low sulfur diesel. So one of the problems is that if you look back in the literature, most of the good structure activity correlation data were done with fairly simple sulfur-containing molecules. Now, if we have to achieve diesel with, for example, less than 100 ppm, you have to remove the sterically hindered. Chen Changsong also mentioned that yesterday, that you have to remove these type of compounds. And these compounds are actually being desulfurized in a quite difficult manner. They can be desulfurized both in the direct route where you form biphenyl type of species in a hydrogen ulcer step, and they can also be hydrogenated first, saturating one of the benzene rings before the sulfur removal. So both of these routes are important. So what we really need to understand in order to achieve ultra-low sulfur diesel in industry, that is the nature of both sites for both routes. Well, life was not quite as difficult just a few years ago, because if you had to produce diesel with a couple of hundred ppm, you're not really removing much of these very refractory compounds, and you're mainly removing more simple sulfur compounds like DBT. And there we see that for such simple molecules, relatively simple molecules, it is in fact the direct hydrogenolysis route which is most important. So it's not until recently that you really have to worry about the hydrogenation activity. Well, these type of results, of course, suggest that different sites are involved in the two routes, because you see that they respond differently to steric constraints. Well, how do we get some information about the nature of the sites for these routes? Well, one traditional way, and maybe one of the few, only ways that we could really attack such a problem, was to do detailed kinetic studies, do poison effects, and so on and so forth. But as we heard in the talk by also Bert Davis yesterday, that from kinetic studies you can of course get some good ideas, and maybe you can exclude some mechanism, But you can never prove a mechanism, and you can never really prove the nature of the science just from kinetic studies. But anyway, this was really the only way that people could, until very recently, attack this problem. Or one of the few ways. So, still, this is very important, and it is very important to look at some of these steric and poisoning effects. And many people have over the years studied it, and actually one of the most important early papers was written by Molinar together with Frank Masler during his stay in the United States, and they clearly concluded that you should have different type of sites. And at that time there was actually quite a bit of argument, and so I think this was a very important early study. There has also been a lot of interesting studies by Gates and Carbon, Mochida, ourselves, Brinara, and Chun Sang Song has also done interesting studies. And so many people have really studied the inhibition effects. And I'd like to summarize some of these key effects because they're very important. And as you can see, that they are very different from the direct route and the hydrogenation route. The direct group, we see that the substituents mainly influence the direct group, but not the hydrogenation group. If you take the inhibition by H2S, you see that you have, again, a very large inhibition by H2S on the direct group, but hardly any inhibition on the hydrogenation group. And I think that is one of the observations which people have really not been able to for many years to understand. And this is really trouble for them. Then you have the effect that the inhibition by aromatics on the hydrogenation route is quite small. But as soon as you have nitrogen, and especially basic nitrogen compounds, you have a very large inhibition. And this is one of the most important industrial problems. And if you have to treat crack feedstocks, LCO and other feedstocks, you have to understand the inhibition by the nitrogen compounds. And this is one of the things which can really make it difficult for you to achieve ultra-low sulfur diesel in a refinery. So this is something that we need to understand. And I'll return, and I think, and I hope to show you in a few minutes that we can now start to understand this. Well, another way where you can get information about the nature of the sites is, of course, to conduct in situ studies and then try to correlate activities with different spectroscopic or structural information, just like the structure activity correlations I showed you previously from Moskva spectroscopy or from X-FABs. And what we saw before was that it's really the cobalt edge atoms in the coma structures, which are the active ones in the promoted catalyst or the nickel edge in the nickel promoted systems. If you go to the unpromoted systems, it is still the edge atoms. And people have over the years found many different ways of titrating the edge atoms in promoted and unpromoted atoms. You can do it with chemical methods like oxygen chemisorption, NO chemisorption, and we will hear a talk at 2 o'clock by Professor Yamada. I think he will also introduce a little bit about the use of NO adsorption. And this turns out to be a very useful probe molecule. You can also do it with CO chemisorption. So many of these techniques, and also physical techniques, or structural techniques like X-FABs and ESR, can titrate the edge atoms. And what you typically see is, for unpromoted catalysts, that the activity is related to the edge atoms. And this is for the direct route. You see that it's correlated. This is some more data from Exxon. We have similar data ourselves, and other people have reported similar results. And you can do it with NO and CO. But what has amazed people is that when you look at hydrogenation reactions, you see correlations also, which are more or less similar. So you have a correlation between the hydrogenation activity and the number of edge atoms you also have in these catalysts. So this actually have proposed some people to say that these sites are similar. And actually one of my co-workers about 10 years ago made a very detailed kinetic model, and also Slavik Castellan has made such a model, where you can actually treat some of the kinetics with the same sites for hydrogenation and for the direct desulfurization. But I think all of you know, as long as we have many parameters in our kinetics, we can fit almost any data with whatever mechanism we're interested in. And I think that was one of the main points of Bert Davis yesterday, that you cannot really use the kinetics as a proof of a mechanism. But anyway, people have been troubled a little bit about how can you have these sites intact very differently with poisons, but still you have fairly similar type of activity correlations. Well, in bulk MOS2, you have two type of edges. You have the so-called molybdenum edge, the 1-0, -1-0 edge, and you have the so-called sulfur edge. So one proposal by Xiaoling Ma, who was working together with Chunchang Song, was that maybe the hydrogenation reaction occurs on one of the edges, the molybdenum terminated edge, and maybe the direct desulfurization occurs on the other edge. And that would, of course, fit the activity correlations I showed before. It can also explain a lot of the inhibition effects that I mentioned before. But a key question is, do you really have such structures? And one of the things which was a little bit difficult to understand, at least to our mind, how can you explain this inhibition by nitrogen compounds using this proposal? So the key problem is, of course, until that time, no one, neither we or anyone else, really knew whether molybdenum disulfide species or chromo structures looked like this in a reactor. So the key problem was that we had not, or we had never observed the atomic structure and had never observed the sites directly. So we thought, well, how can we get some information about the atomic structure? Well, at that time, we were working together with Fleming Wiesenbacher on copper catalyst, on model systems, doing more or less surface science type experiments with STM, scanning tunneling microscopy. And we thought that maybe this technique, the scanning tunneling microscopy, should be able to resolve the structure of these sulfides. However, it took about 3 years to convince Fleming Wiesenbacher to put these sulfides into his nice ultra-high vacuum chamber, because of course you are afraid of completely destroying your instruments. But anyway, we finally solved that problem, and it turned out that this technique is absolutely beautifully well suited to study such catalysts. And the reason it is so nicely suited is that the sulfides are two-dimensional. So instead of studying platinum catalysts and other catalysts where the nanocrystals are more three-dimensional, you actually have that these sulfides, the COMOS and the NEMOS and the MOS2 structures are two-dimensional. So you can get beautifully atomically resolved images. And this is just the first result, which was just obtained more or less at the time I last visited Dehradun, but we were not really talking about it at that time because we were not quite sure what we were observing. But what you see right away is that this structure, this triangular structure, is of course completely different from the bulk hexagonal structure that we have been thinking about and others have been thinking about before. We also see that once you go to the edges, these edges are not the type of edge structures that you would think about if you consider the bulk structure. So what is happening at the edges, these crystals completely reconstruct. Of course, in many other systems, we know that the surfaces reconstruct. So this we also have here, that the edges, and the edges are the important structures here, that they also reconstruct. So we completely have to rethink our thinking about hydrotreating catalysts. The structures were quite different from what anyone had to been thinking about. But the nice thing is that now we have direct images. So we have a good impact of how to construct, let's say, new ideas about how to look at these catalysts. Well, you can also do these type of experiments under different conditions, and we can see that we can create vacancies, and later on I will also show you, we can see how molecules can interact with these vacancies. But these vacancies, we believe that they are really the active sites for the direct route and not for the hydrogenation route. And when we have to produce ultra-low sulfur diesel in our refineries, I just told you before, we need to understand the hydrogenation. So this does not really help us understanding the hydrogenation. Well, now I will tell you what helped and what really stopped. And this is probably one of the most surprising features of hydrotreating catalysts, and probably also the most important feature for obtaining clean transport fuels. And this is these yellow sites, this yellow brim, which is located just inside the edge itself. And it turns out at these sites you have high electron density. And this is quite amazing, because these are not coordinatively unsaturated sites like you would have if you had a vacancy or in oxides like we have been hearing about. So this is not exposed under coordinated metal atoms, which gives this metallic character. They are completely covered with sulfur, but still we have metallic character. So that was completely surprising. Anyway, now we have done the full DFT calculations of these type of structures, we know the band structures, so we know the origin and we actually understand why such small nanocrystals should have metallic sites. Well, once you have metallic sites, you will of course expect that they can do some chemistry. And that is in fact the case. Here I show thiophene molecules sitting side by side on top of the brim sites. So these brim sites are in fact, these very new and unusual brim sites are in fact able to do chemistry. They can absorb thiophene and they can also absorb other molecules. They don't absorb very strongly. So if we just heat up this catalyst, this sample, without having hydrogen around, thiophene simply dissolves and no chemistry is going on. You are not achieving any HDS whatsoever. It is just dissolving. Well, what about hydrogen? If you have hydrogen around, we can also with STM observe how hydrogen interacts with the sulfide structures. And what we see is that hydrogen is actually dissociating on these sites, which turns out to be some dimeric type of sulfur sites. And they dissociate. This is perhaps not very surprising that you have SH groups in these catalysts. And in fact, about 10 years ago, we found by use of infrared spectroscopy that you do have SH groups. But when you do these type of spectroscopies, you can maybe see that you have SH groups in the sample, but you do not know where in the sample are these SH groups. So the big advance is, again, by doing these STM images, you can directly see where do you have these SH groups. You can pinpoint them in space. And what turns out is that these hydrogens, they are not sticking out away from the surface. They are actually quite mobile, and they are moving up on top of the crystal, very close to the brim sites, which are located just a little bit inside from the edge. So what happens when you expose both to the reactant thiophene and have hydrogen at the same time? Then, of course, you see reactions. So here, we are lucky that also by STM you are able to pick out the results of elementary steps going on. So you are very lucky with this technique that you can track different results of different elementary steps so you can understand what's going on. It is not that straightforward because you cannot really see whether this is the dihydro, tetrahydro, thiophene or whatever. But what is nice and what you can do today by density functional theory is that you can calculate the complete structure from all sort of intermediates. And once you calculate the electronic structure, then you can simulate STM pictures based on the DFT calculations, and then you can compare simulated with observed images. And when we do that, we can see that this is actually a cis-butene thiolate. So what is happening at the brim site? You are able to both hydrogenate and also cleave the first carbon-sulfur bond. So you end up with this cis-butene thiolate. So of course we're not finished yet. But we know that thiolates, which is just the equivalent of a thiols, thiols are extremely reactive. So the last step is actually quite easy. We can see that this can then move to a vacancy. And this last step in the hydrogenation path should be a little bit poisoned by H2S. And by very careful kinetic studies, recently Roland Prince has seen that this very last step in this pathway is in fact inhibited. So that fits absolutely perfectly. So one of our students, Paul Georg Moses, has recently completed 2 years extremely careful and time-consuming and computer-consuming study where he has done all the pathways on different type of initial structures with different sulfur coverages and so on and so forth, hydrogen coverages and so on. I'm not going into all those details, but what you can do is not only calculate the energetics of the different steps, but you can also calculate the activation energies. And this is, of course, what is important and what dictates the activity. So you can see there's a whole row of hydrogenation steps, hydrogen transfer steps, C-accession steps, and then of course at the end of the cycle you have to regenerate the step. And not surprisingly, this is actually a quite energy consuming, so it is a kinetic important step also. So now you are in a fantastic situation that you can use this activation energy and all the energetics to create microkinetic models. And these are, of course, very different from the real kinetic models because now you can introduce the direct observed elementary steps and all the energetics that we either observe or can calculate. So this is really kinetic models based on direct observations. Okay. Under real hydrotreating conditions, you may have different partial pressures in your industrial reactors, and you may actually have some structural transformations going on, and you may expose, beside the molybdenum terminated edge, you may also expose the sulfur terminated edge. So what we have been doing is calculating all the hydrogenation and the dielectric groups for both type of edges. I will not go through all the detail. It's actually quite complicated, and the stability of the intermediates may actually be quite different from the roots. So what you can actually have is that the catalysis may start on one of the edges, and then you have quite a bit of mobility, and some of the intermediates may move to another edge where you can complete the catalysis. So in reality, things may be a little bit more difficult, but at least we now understand the energetics and we understand what are the key steps and what are the difficult steps. So I think it's quite clear that you can now start to understand a lot of the things. We can understand these activity correlations that we did with NO adsorption, CO adsorptions, and other methods, where we saw that the hydrogenation activity showed similar type of activity correlations as a direct. I have heard it, and I'll try to give it. So we understand the. What can I have, maybe 5 minutes? So, of course, the brim sites, they're located right behind the edge. So the concentration of the brim sites is not that different from the concentration of the edge sites. So that explains very nicely why you see these similar activity correlations. And let me very fastly just explain how you can very easily understand now the hydrogenation activities, which has been the difficult thing to understand. On top of the brim site, it's a very open site, so it's really easy to understand that the effect of substituents is very small. It is a fully coordinated site by sulfur. And we have actually done calculations of H2S, there's no interaction whatsoever. So that explains very nicely why the hydrogenation step itself is not inhibited by H2S. But what about this difference between the aromatic and the nitrogen, the basic nitrogen compounds, which is very important industrially? Can we also understand that? And the answer is yes, because a simple aromat, just a salt like thiophene on top of the brim, is not very strong. It's not a very strong adsorption, so it does not give rise to a very strong inhibition. However, when you have the basic nitrogen compound, you can interact both to the brim and to the SH group out there. So you end up with a much stronger interaction of the basic nitrogen compounds, and that is the origin of the strong inhibition that you also observe in industry. Well, how can we make better catalysts? Well, one of the things that I mentioned before is that you can make the type 2 structures, but now we can also understand why the type 2 structures, which is very important in industrial catalysts, why they're more active, because in the type 2 structures, you do not quench the brim. It also influences the structure in other ways. However, if you have bonds to the support, you really change the electronic properties. Another thing you can do, and which a lot of people have been looking at, is the structure sensitivity. Look at what happens if you try to make even smaller nanocrystals, and that can have dramatic effects, also as shown by Wayne Goodman and Enrique Iglesias. So what happens in hydrotreating? We know that hydrotreating is extremely structure sensitive because the basal planes themselves are not doing any catalysis. So in here, nothing is going on. Everything occurs at the edges and at the brim side. So we have seen what happens with the intrinsic properties when you change the size. In the beginning, not too much happens. But still, you can have tremendous changes in the observed catalytic activity because the S dispersion and the brim dispersion may change, and that will also depend on stacking effects and on the support interactions. But what happens? But you can see the brim is more or less the same and the bonding properties are not that different. But what happens when you went down to very small sizes? Well, recently we were able to make some very small nanocrystals of MOS2, and it turned out we can get some beautifully atomically resolved images, and the new journal, Nature Nanotechnology, put this image on the front issue of the January issue this year. So what happens when you go down to the very small sizes? Then you see a lot of things are changing. We understand that we can do DFT calculations, and the calculations fit absolutely perfectly with what we observed. But one thing we, for example, see is that you get a complete reversal of the type of edges which are exposed. Up here it is a molybdenum terminated, down here it's a sulfur terminated edges. So this is quite complicated, but that is kind of nice because this gives us all sort of ideas of how could you maybe make new catalysts with changing properties. So there's a lot of opportunities open to modify the structures. You can also make many different types of promoted structures. I have no time to talk about those. But what is clear is that we have entered really an era where we understand the atomic and the molecular structure of the catalyst, and also understand the reactions, and we understand the hydrogenation sites. So we have been using this information, and the first family of catalysts based on this atomic insight of the so-called RIM family of catalysts. There are many catalysts for low pressure, high pressure, for crack feedstocks, straight feedstocks, and whatever. But the key point is that within a short area of time, just from 1980, so within 25 years of time, we have moved from a state where we knew nothing about the catalyst, to a state where we know all sorts of things about the nanostructure. So coming back to the panel discussion yesterday, I agree with that, what everyone is saying, that In 2 years, we don't know what we are going to see. There will be also new beautiful materials for all sorts of reactions and catalysis which can help us solve environmental problems and others. So things are going very rapidly, and we are having a lot of new possibilities, both in hydrotreating, but certainly also in other fields. Okay, I will not say very much, but I can just say that some of these new brim catalysts, there are 100 hydrotreaters around the world. They are processing close to, I think this is a little bit outdated, but more than 3 million barrels per day of clean diesel. So why do you choose some of these more active catalysts? And I think that is maybe not trivial, because in some areas of catalysis, it does not really pay very much to have more activity. But in the area of clean transport fuels, it can really pay and give the refiner a huge economic benefit to have a more active catalyst and more selective catalyst. And several people have published papers, this is not our paper, but several people have mentioned that it can really pay for the refiner to have more active catalyst. And it can really, the payback time of a more active catalyst can be in a few months in some cases. So how can you use it? There are many different options. I think some of the most interesting options for the refiner is to increase the throughput or try to take some of these heavy feeds that we have to process now. We are running out of sweet crudes, as we heard yesterday. So I think a very attractive option is to process heavier feeds. Okay, FCC, they are also used for FCC pretreatment. I think I will skip that, but also quite a few million barrels of FCC is processed using these brim catalysts now. So I think in your time that I will not say anything more. I will not repeat everything I've said, but I hope I have convinced you that we have really moved into a new area where we can use all the atomic insight to tailor-make new industrial catalysts, and that it is extremely important to use all these new theoretical and experimental tools that we will also hear more about and have heard about at this meeting. So I think that the future of catalysis is very exciting, and it's a great pleasure for me to be here. And I'd like to thank the organizers again and thank all of you for your attention.
Heard an excellent exposition of taking from the atomic level into the high pressure reactors, and the I was sitting here, but my hand is not going towards bell at all, in spite of the fact that I'm listening to something that I don't want to be distracted. No, it is great to be here. It's this type of exposition of this one from the atomic detail of it, I never thought of this. So, thank you very much for the excellent read that you have given to our viewers. Thank you.
Because that great facility by being coordinated to molybdenum, that can absorb bases and poison the hydrogenation. And when you go from the large triangle size to the small triangle, the number of exposed molybdenum goes down, gets more and more covered by sulfur. And that can explain probably the improved activity, because the acidity of the sulfhydride group, I would expect to go down when you go from the large triangle to the small triangle. So have you measured the acidity of this of the sulfhydride group?
It's a very good question, and it's a very important issue. And like I showed, it's very important for the poisoning,
right,
to understand that.
Right.
So if you can control it, that is of course a very desirable situation. So we have in fact tried to measure the sulfur, the acidity. We can also calculate it, and I can say without revealing too much that it does change. We are also using these, and Jens Nørskov and Berit Hinnemann are also studying these in electrocatalysis, mm-hmm, and in trying to modify to modify the bond strength.
So I think there's hope that we can use it, and actually I think there's hope to also make some very interesting electric catalysts.
One can estimate, they say something absorbs around 2500 in the infrared.
Yes.
For the Ethiopia, the publication of Transactions of Fire Society.
Yes.
So if you can get a correlation between the reduction in the 2500 band on absorption of beryllium and the increase in the 1540 band with beryllium cation, and the active poisoning effect, you would establish a linkage between the concentration of the sulfide group and the poisoning by bases and the activity.
Exactly. And actually, what you have in here, and I didn't show that, the pyridine itself does not absorb that strong, but you have to have actually formation of the pyridinium ion.
Right.
And that is actually the one that's absorbing very strongly. So you're absolutely correct.
Thank you.
Sir, B. Kumar from IOCF. Can the in situ technique be used for monitoring the performance of the batches which are already operating in the reactors? Say, catalyst purging activity mode of purging?
Well, it is of course difficult to take these in situ techniques directly to the industrial plant. Because if you use X-Labs today, you use a synchrotron, and these synchrotrons are very big things, and you cannot move a synchrotron to your refinery. There's possibilities, and people are trying to make laptop synchrotrons. What you could do is probably take a side stream reactor, because the big high pressure reactor is difficult to get the radiation in and out of the wall. So what we are doing is, of course, we are having a laboratory pilot plants, and specially designed pilot plants in the laboratory, where we have special reactors where you can have the high pressure, and have the right temperatures, have the right feedstock, and then do the measurements there. And we know from our experience that what we can measure and calculate in the laboratory from the feedstocks that we get from the refinery fits perfectly with, let's say, the operation in the refinery. So you can do it in this way.
Next question. These nitrogenous compounds usually create problems with the FCC catalyst, with hydrotreating and hydrocarbon, all those catalysts. So what preparation have been taken by TOPSO for these nitrogenous compounds?
Well, simply, we have done all these experiments in the laboratory. It is very difficult to go all the way from the microkinetic to make industrial kinetics. I think, and Chacha will talk later on, that in a real feed, you have thousands of sulfur compounds and other compounds. So it is very difficult to make, let's say, complete fundamental kinetics of the industrial operation. But what you can do is that you can model some of the key steps. So what we do is that we go front and back between model feedstocks, and the typical feedstocks that we use in the laboratory for more fundamental studies are actually mixed feeds, where we at the same time have both hydrogenation, HTS, direct hydrogenation routes, and also nitrogen compounds. So we have mixed feedstocks. And then we go front and back between those, and then laboratory pilot plants or process units using the real feedstocks that we get from the refinery. And then, of course, you build up on experience, and then you can use that experience to design or to select what catalyst will be best in a given situation. And quite often in a reactor, you just don't fill one catalyst. You grade the chemistry, and you grade the activity and the type of chemistry you have down through a reactor.
In case the vacant sites of sulfur are responsible for this STS reaction, in that case it should be non-stoichiometry of molybdenum and and sulfur, which should be directly related to the catalytic activity. Is there any data?
Well, a lot of these bubble crystals are extremely non-stoichiometric. If you say that they have MOS2 stoichiometry, they don't.
So is there any correlation available? See, where we can show that extent of non-stoichiometry is directly related to the catalytic activity. If we can do in situ, for example, XPS and in situ activity.
Well, there are many old correlations with XPS, and there's also, like, Frank Mazzot also made sulfur analysis measurements. And there are all sort of correlations, but maybe they are not really primary correlations. Maybe the reason that some of these correlations work is related to other effects, not because the excess of sulfur as such is a key parameter. That's not maybe the fundamental parameter. But it is maybe related also to the size, like Paul Ratnasamy just said, and to other things. Because the excess also depends on the size of the the nanocrystal.
In that case, the smaller particles should show poorer activity because all the vacancies will have a tendency to get filled up. So instead of having higher activity, smaller particles should show poorer activity, and then it should get poisoned very fast.
I will tell you the answer next time we meet.
Yes. I have a small doubt. So your study is that you expect. you extrapolated your bulk studies to the supported system, right? You also have a support there of the catalyst, and support has substantial effect the activity of these catalysts. How do you rationalize the formation of the structures of the supports?
Yes, the support is essential. And many people have studied support effects for the last 20 or 30 years. And some of these effects can be quite complicated. They can be due to, let's say, some of the atoms are interacting with the support. They can be due to that if you go to some supports like carbon, the interaction is not very strong. But at the same time, the center and the deactivation can be a little bit different. So it can affect the dispersion. It can be more difficult to disperse on carbon support, but it is possible. And like Machida and we and many other people have formed very highly active catalysts on carbon. But and actually, well, we have done a lot of recent work on carbon support. Actually, we can also study the carbon support with STM. So we have beautiful images of the support interactions with carbon and graphite. And it turns out that you actually have a kind of mismatch, a tilting of the crystals with respect to the lattice of the MOS2. So it's not really a chemical bond, but it's just kind of trying to make an overlayer structure on the graphite. Then in other supports, you have a metal oxygen molybdenum bond. And that is actually what you have in the type 1 structures in the alumina support. Then if you go to serialize, then you have many other things, and SPA and...
What I was trying to say, there are some studies that support acidity, for example, some BFP,
yeah, studies,
that they affect the hydrogenation function on these.
Yes. And all of these things can affect, and I think Yamas is going to have a talk in the afternoon, also using the chelate agents, which is a good way of making type 2. And you can see that these things can affect. You can put additives, and we will hear about additives in the afternoon. So it is very difficult to make general comments. And I said that even if you change the pH in the impregnation solution, something will change. If you change the order of impregnation, things will change. But the key message, I think, that I try to convince is that we can understand it because we have the tools now. 10, 20 years ago, we did not have the tools. So now we can understand preparation parameters and support effects.
One last question, Dr. I'm here. It was a mesmerizing lecture, rather, I should say. Now, I have a question there. When the people are using type 2 sites of catalyst, which you have described yourself, plus the other competitors who are having. Now, when you go for, you have described that they are both direct sulfurization and the true hydrogenation desulfurization, particularly for 4,6-DMDVT. Now, what is the percentage you feel when the simultaneous reaction takes place? Will be direct route and what will be the through hydrogenation? Because that will affect a lot of things using the hydrogen pressure, and that will then one can save a lot of money from the actual hydrogenation.
Again, you cannot come with a general comment. If you increase the hydrogen pressure, of course you increase the hydrogen coverage, and you can influence to what extent that you go the hydrogenation route. But it may not always be desired, because if you have too much hydrogenation activity, you just consume hydrogen. And most refiners today are extremely concerned about using too much hydrogen. So the trick is to only use the hydrogen needed to remove the compounds that you want to remove, and not just to waste hydrogen. So it depends on the hydrogen pressure. It certainly also depends on these poisons that I mentioned, because some of the poisons influence the hydrogenation route more than they influence the other route. So they depend on the feedstocks.
It also depends on the type of the catalyst.
Yes. Absolutely.
So how does it affect the pressure? That's what
I'm Well, some of the, of course, the trick, and I'm not talking about all these details, but the trick that we are trying to do is, of course, modify the catalyst in a way that we have these different possibilities, that we can optimize the catalyst depending on what pressure a refiner has and what feedstock, how much hydrogenation they need, and how much of the direct route they need. And that also depends on how deep they want to go down in sulfur.
Thank you.